Oh, that's a little better. Well, hi. I guess I decided to just do a really short one today, but I wanted to let you know that because now I've gone live, several people have asked, have Googled me. You know, we Google everything, and there is at least one really horrible article about me, and I thought I would just kind of let you know what's really going on there, because, and I found a Carl Bernstein quote, and I had loved this one years and years ago, but he writes, "The lowest form of popular culture, lack of information, misinformation, and a contempt for the truth or the reality of, let's see, or the reality of the of other people's lives has overrun journalism." Let's see, what does this say? Has overrun journalism. Mm-hmm. Let's see. Today. Yes, of course. Ordinary Americans are being stuffed with garbage. And that's true. We are being stuffed with garbage. And then another quote he says is, "We are in the process of creating what deserves to be called the idiot culture." So, and mine's going on low power mode, so I guess I have to plug this in here. So just bear with me a second, because this is going to be good. Anyway, let's do that. Yeah, let's start this and get this going. Okay. So, what I wanted to talk about was that here we are. We are approaching the winter solstice, and there is a heavy energy that is still purging. It is bubbling up, you know, whenever there's a heavier, dense energy coming through, then all that stuff comes up to the surface. And so that's what we're seeing a lot of right now. And so it was articles that had been written about me, and you know, I made the front page of the Chicago Sun-Times, and I was on the news, and this and this, and believe me, I'm not wearing it as a badge to be proud of. I am letting you know that the wealthy, the powerful, and the corrupt can sometimes, you know, control the media and what we're reading. So use discernment in everything, whether it's meeting new people or whether it's reading whatever is out there anyway. And and you know what? For me, I must say that it actually allowed me, because I was so humiliated and so defamed and so so embarrassed by it all, and that's why my children haven't spoken to me, because they just said, "Mom, this was totally unnecessary, and in our book, you know, you're just dead." And I was like, "Oh my gosh." But I had to write the letter, and I will tell you that in 1980 I was studying, I was taking medical school classes, I was doing research on the brain and spinal cord using the electron microscope, and I was teaching nurses anatomy lab. And I was very happy, and I was going to get 2 degrees in about 6 more years. And so my father came down and said, "Enough of this, you're a good little Greek girl." And good little Greek girls don't just spend their lives in a lab. You don't need to do this. And so you need to get married, and here is a wonderful man who wants to marry you. And it was somebody I had dated on and off at Northwestern. And so my father said, "I'm not paying for your tuition anymore. Let's go." So so I ended up writing my research as a master's thesis, and then my dad gave us this big, beautiful wedding in Chicago at the Ambassador West Hotel in the Guildhall, and there were, you know, like, it was just, it was overdone. But anyway, that's what, you know, parents are the ones that choose what kind of wedding they want for their daughters, basically. And so, and he was paying for it. So, so we did that. We had this wedding, and then we went on a honeymoon to Hawaii. We went island hopping, between 3 islands. And so in Maui, I think he's my ex-husband on our wedding night, or the wedding night after, the night after the wedding night, because the wedding night we were up till 3 o'clock in the morning packing and getting things ready to fly out. So the day after, my ex-husband said to me, "I wouldn't sleep with you if you're the last woman on earth." And I said, "Oh my gosh, I only weigh 118 pounds. What are you talking about?" So it was, I didn't know what to do. I was just so shocked, you know, but I didn't understand. And he didn't even understand. And so, you know, he had this wonderful job offer. And we were going to New York. We were going to live there. And I think that he said, "I married you for your father's money." And I was like, okay. And I was like in shock. So the point of this is that it has given me an understanding. And thank God we are no longer in 1980 and we are in the year 2020, because that's not going to happen to my daughter. My ex-husband, I think, was trying to figure out his own sexuality, and I didn't fit in to his version of it. And so he was just not interested in sex. He just wasn't interested in me or any woman. And so now, I mean, I went through 20 years of thinking there was something wrong with me. Like, I imagine that there are other women who are in the same boat or were in the same boat. I think now it's just so amazing that people can be more of their authentic selves, and they don't feel like because of convention and because of a job that they have to put on this facade of this, you know, wife and children and home and everything. I mean, they can be who they really are. And I mean, so we have really, really progressed in that respect, and that's really wonderful. But when I saw, and when I did, after 16 years, I actually had an affair. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is what I've been missing for 16 years. And so I'm not saying that that was the right thing to do, but for me it was, because it allowed me to kind of affirm to myself, to validate. My femininity was validated. So a lot of us, you know, we're on planet Earth, where it's just really one test after another. And this is a big test. I mean, marriage is a big test, and being adored by your spouse is a very big test. And so it's what we expect and what we deserve. We deserve to give them all the love we can, and they deserve, and we deserve to receive that in return, because they're, I mean, it's all love, right? And so when you've got other filters through, like, oh, you're female, I don't want you, but, well, tell me that this is not what you want in life, and don't ruin my life. But actually, he didn't ruin my life, because I did have 4 children with him. The 4th one was through artificial insemination, and the others, I was very, very fertile, and I wanted a baby, like, and I got it right there. And so I know this is more than you want to hear, probably, but the point of this is that now is the time to take your power, and you don't have to, you're not living in the past. And so much of the rules and the structures and the limitations we have on planet Earth are all BS. I mean, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. And public opinion doesn't matter. Now, because I, when he said, oh, if you leave, because after 16 years, I was filing for divorce, I wanted to leave. And he said, if you leave, I'll destroy you. And then we had a 4.5-year custody, you know, legal battle and blah, blah, blah. And then I wrote the letter about how men and women, you know, who are on the wrong, who don't have the powerful positions anymore, how they are so betrayed and defamed and vilified by the press and by their friends and by the attorneys and by everyone. And so I wrote that letter and I said, you know, there's a lot of injustice going on in family law. And then he sued me and then he got a $10 million judgment and then that gave him carte blanche to my inheritance. But anyway, the point is when, you know, my picture was all over the papers and stuff, I then became a public figure. Well, let me tell you, I have total compassion for celebrities and people you see on television, because being a public figure means you have no privacy at all. So when I used to feel like people are on my phone and why is this clicking and why is that and who's that and this, you know, they can say, oh, she's just imagining things. But really, when you are deemed a public figure, then they can film you going to the bathroom. I mean, they can film you in your most intimate moments. They can film you everywhere you go and listen to everything you do and say and watch you and everything. And so I wish that I would have understood that then. Instead, I would just get mad and I'd go, well, why are you here? Or who's listening? Or I don't give you permission to listen to my phone calls. I would have used that as kind of like, that would be like God listening, you know, so that we want to do our best. But I didn't do my best because I was angry that someone was invading my privacy and I didn't get the whole public figure thing. I just didn't. But anyway, so the bottom line is that, you know, it doesn't matter what the public thinks about us. It doesn't matter what your neighbors think about you. It doesn't even matter what your family thinks about you. You be your own person. You be your authentic self. And if you are in a marriage that doesn't work, for whatever reason, get the hell out. And I didn't take my own advice. But it's really, we have to just, you know, run. We have to be motivated through our heart, not our mind. You know, everybody can say, oh, well, you know, finances are this, and so I should really stay because I don't know about this, and where would I live, and blah, blah, blah. I mean, you know, you have to think with your heart and not your head. And let's see, what else can I tell you? And stay strong. And as things are being, you know, thrown at you, just know that that's the dark. And it is to help you see a better way. You're not to stay there. You're not to do that. You're to awaken. You know, you're here to do the work. I mean, why are we on planet Earth, right? I mean, I'm sure that people that are listening are rather spiritual. And so you're here to do the work. This isn't an easy time to be here. This isn't an easy ride. This is a tough time. This is the time when we are ascending. This is the time when we are purging a lot of the negative constructs that have been, you know, thrown our way. And it's a time of seeing the joy in life. It's a time of understanding other people. If I knew that about my ex, I would have been a whole different person to him instead of feeling so sexually frustrated and thinking, what's the matter with me? Other people think I'm okay. Why don't you? And you're my husband. But instead, I internalized it and I just kind of got really sad. And so it doesn't matter what anyone thinks about you. Just do your own thing, stay strong, and have compassion and understanding. Oh, that's what I was going to get at, is that when people mistreat you, when they vilify you, when they talk about you, when they, whatever it is they do, when they betray you, all you have to do is just try to understand who they are and what their perspective is. Because, yeah, if I were a gay man and I felt the need to have to marry and be in a relationship with a woman who was very sexual and wanted a good relationship, and I wasn't interested, yeah, I think I would really have I would understand how he felt. And you know what I mean? It's really put yourself in somebody else's place instead of judging. I wish I would have, you know, put my arms around him and said, you know what, this relationship isn't working, so why are we here? You know, let's just peacefully separate. and you go your way and I'll go mine. But instead it was like, oh, if you leave, it's going to ruin the facade and I'm going to have to destroy you. I mean, that's like crazy stuff. So, and when people say, oh, she's just imagining things, she's hallucinating, oh, and, you know, I mean, what else can they say, right? Because sometimes our stories are so fantastic. Even we are just like, wow, thank God I actually got through that. That was nutso. So anyway, to replace the negative with the positive and just move forward and think about the wonderful life you're creating now moving forward. Right? So what else can I tell you? Just that this is life on planet Earth. And I'll just make one more caveat, which is that for those people who have some type of an understanding of twin flames, the twin flames are here to raise the energy of the planet and of the collective, but only after they have purged a lot of the negativity of the collective. And so a lot of us have been going through that we had to have a lot of that stuff thrown at us so that we could let it go and we could understand it and we could now see it with compassion. And so that's basically what we're doing now. We are seeing the light in what has been some very dark places. And so that's what I think we need to do. Yeah. And so for those of you who are twin flames or think you're twin flames or whatever, just stay strong and know that you are really doing good work and that you've had an extra test because twin flames really, actually they've been positioned, what I've read is they've been positioned in different parts of the world in order to balance out the energies. And so it is now the time when many will come together in order to raise the vibe of everyone else. So, all right, so stay strong and know who you are and don't let anybody tell you otherwise. And they can look at you and they can, you know, call you all kinds of names and say, you know, you're crazy, you're a spiritual woo-woo crazy person and you hallucinate and, you know, it's like, okay, if that's what you think, you're entitled to your opinion. So anyway, all right. I love you, and I will see you again soon. Stay strong. Bye-bye.